From gorillas on the loose to the hoopla over a Hollywood heartthrob. From Big Brother watching you to the latest political happenings in our metro, welcome to another edition of Kansas City Week in Review. I'm Nick Haynes, and it's good to be with you as we take you behind the headlines making news in Kansas City. With us to dissect some of those headline-grabbing stories this week are Dana Wright, now behind the microphones as co-host of Radioactive, 2 to 6 each weekday afternoon on News Radio 98.1 FM KMBZ. From 41 Action News, chief political reporter Chris Hernandez, Kansas City Star reporter, blogger and columnist Dave Helling, and Star syndicated columnist Mary Sanchez. Now, there's been, by and large, lukewarm news interest in Kansas City's so-called Green Impact Zone, the more than two-year-old effort led by local Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver to weatherize and improve a struggling 150-block area on Kansas City's east side. But every news outlet got suddenly interested this week when word got out that movie actor Brad Pitt was getting involved. A big announcement was scheduled, and Chris Hernandez, you were there. Here's your report. We'll go behind the story with our panel in just a moment. Yeah, what's
the name? Stephen Boyd cleans up the grounds before dignitaries arrive for the big announcement. He went to Bancroft School and lives nearby.
Well, I'm excited, to be honest with you. It's just another step in redeveloping the community. It's pretty sad to see so many of the schools close and become blighted areas.
The $14 million project will renovate a school building that was abandoned more than a decade ago. $2.3 million of the cost is being raised by the Make It Right Foundation, started by actor Brad Pitt to help rebuild New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. The redevelopment will have a contemporary look and include 50 housing units, and it's supported by Pitt's superstardom.
Brad Pitt is as famous as I should have been, but I mean, we're working together in this.
Jermaine Reed worked for the Green Impact Zone before becoming a council member. Some have criticized the zone for slow progress, and this is the first significant private investment since the zone was formed almost 3 years ago.
Change doesn't happen overnight. It takes a number of conversations. It takes a number of partnership that everyone has to play a part in. And this one is one that took some time, and now we're here to this point.
Surrounding blocks are blighted, even though it's just a mile or so east of the Country Club Plaza. Officials hope the project will finally spark more private investment and attract returning residents.
The good news today is that we are now going to make it right.
Again, the Green Impact Zone has been around for over 2.5 years, but it is something to be said, Dana Wright, about having a mega superstar, something involved in the story, even though he never came to town.
I kept saying, how do I get out of television the week Brad Pitt's coming? Now, tell he didn't come!
No, he will be coming.
To the huge disappointment, maybe, of course, of the media that
everyone,
he wasn't here. Though,
everyone in the newsroom was saying, is he coming? Is he coming? I mean, they all sort of assumed he was going to be here this week, but he'll probably be in Kansas City for the groundbreaking, which will be sometime this summer.
So what was the connection with Brad Pitt, and why was he somehow involved with this?
Well, of course, as you may know, he is from Springfield, Missouri, raised there. He did a few classes at Mizzou, never really graduated, but he has really kept ties to Missouri, and the architect, who is sort of the link between the local architecture firm that is helping them in New Orleans as well, he is a Kansas City native, Tim Dugan, and he's involved in this project, and he sort of helped bring all of this together.
One school, though, in what is a 150-block area, are we making too much of a deal about this, Mary?
I don't think so, because I do think that people need to pay attention to what happens to those schools, and if it takes Brad Pitt to make that occur, yes. These projects are very, very hard to redevelop. I mean, even in your reporting, it's been shown that, you know, you have to build together all these tax credits, all these historic tax credits. There's just huge issues in getting this done. And hopefully, maybe people follow the story a little bit more.
Dave, you've also been doing a lot of reporting on the Green Impact Zone,
right,
and it's not always met its expectations along the way. What is this story telling us this week?
Well, Congressman Cleaver worked very, very hard for many months to try and put this deal together, and he's pretty excited about the potential that a project like this could encourage other development in the Green Impact Zone. But what Mary said is important to remember. It takes a lot of blending of credits and incentives and donations, and the problem, one of the problems in the Green Impact Zone is there isn't enough of that. I mean, it's hand-to-hand combat for this school. It might be on the next block. It may be two blocks away. The ambition for the Green Impact Zone is extraordinarily high. The execution, both in terms of manpower and dollars, may always fall a little bit short of the goals that Congressman Cleaver and others set for him. And in that sense, it's almost set up some ways, Nick, for disappointment.
Dana.
I want to just say I think we need to make sure, you know, when John Covington blew in and then blew out, shuttered these 36 buildings, they were going to hire this czar to oversee all these buildings. And even though this particular building's been closed for 10 years, I think we all need to do a better job of keeping track of what's happening with all of these dilapidated properties. And if you can't redevelop them into something meaningful, raise them and make green space so they don't become blighted like the one that we saw. And now that Covington's gone, we're not hearing about these properties anymore.
The central problem in the Green Impact Zone are abandoned properties, not just schools, but vacant lots, old homes that need to be pulled down. It's extraordinarily expensive to do that and complicated. That's why any major improvement, it's great to say we have a building czar for schools that are no longer open, but what do you do with them? I mean, somebody's got to figure that out.
No, Dana makes an excellent point, though. Right. There was supposed to be this whole plan to have redevelopment of those schools, find new uses for them.
They do have that, and those proposals have been recently due, and they're still coming in. Part of what the public doesn't realize, though, is that not every school that you see that's vacant still belongs to the Kansas City School District. Right. Horace Mann did not belong, the one that burned, that beautiful old building, incredibly historical significance. It didn't belong to the district anymore. But the image is it's part of the district, and that doesn't let the district off the hook. They do need to make sure that they do something with these properties because they are linked to their image.
And if you talk about the blight in that area, I walked that block this week, and in the 4300 block of Tracy, I was suddenly reminded I'd been there before to do a story about blight 2 or 3 years ago. There are only about 3 occupied houses on that entire block. And this project, in and of itself, does not fix that problem. The hope is that somehow it will have the spillover effect and other people will come in and fix up the surrounding blocks.
The other thing about the Brad Pitt's foundation, and it said, oh, this is his money, $2.3 million. Is it really his money?
It is money that the foundation is raising, and they already have commitments for half of that 2.6. They've got 1.3 committed and say that they will raise the rest of that money fairly easily, they think. This is only the third project that they've done. They've done New Orleans, they've done Newark, New Jersey, and now this, and there's a possibility they may do something in Joplin they're looking
at. And the foundation has been extraordinarily successful in New Orleans, but the difference was, of course, that the flood, in essence, cleared the blight.
Right.
Provided then vacant property for these new architecturally compelling structures to spring up. It isn't clear that there's a strategy in the Green Impact Zone to sort of erase the tablet and allow those kinds of projects to go forward.
And one other thing to point out on that line is that this is something that the foundation came to Kansas City for because they liked the mission of the Green Impact Zone. So that's part of how this started. And they do have some designs on perhaps having a phase two.
Yay. Good.
When 2 400-pound gorillas get loose from their enclosure and visitors at the zoo are herded to safety inside, there's going to be lots of attention and questions that need answering. It's a story that got a lot of news press this week nationally. Zoo employees used water hoses to prod the animals back into their habitat after about 3 hours. And 2 employees have been disciplined for failing to lock the door to the gorilla enclosure.
We just didn't follow our own established protocol yesterday. We take this very seriously, and the people will, they know they made an error, and nobody feels worse than they do. But now we will follow through with some sort of disciplinary protocol with them.
Now, it sounds alarming, but was the public in any danger, Chris Hernandez?
Technically, no. I actually have some friends who were out at the zoo that day, and everyone was put into other buildings, and the gorillas only went into an area that is only accessible to the zookeepers within the complex. So technically, no, but obviously, you can just imagine if they somehow had gotten out into a different area, that could have been a much different situation.
Now, I chose this story because this is the kind of story that plays on those newscasts all across the country. And we saw them, if you go onto YouTube, because you'll see it in California and in Miami. In Kansas City this week, gorillas got loose. And this footage was played all across the country. So irrespective of all those other stories happening in Kansas City this week, Dana, that was one of the stories that was being seen.
It made me giggly. You know me, I love the zoo. I love everything zoo. As long as we get the penguins, I don't care that there are gorillas on the loose. I mean, really, that's how much I love the zoo. But I will say this, very lucky no one got hurt. And I thought it said something about just animal nature, that it was a padlock. And it was a gorgeous day, and these two male gorillas figured out that that padlock is unlocked, and darn it, I'm going to go for a stroll. And they both did it. And I thought,
when they were looking at the female
they're
gorillas,
so smart. I thought it was funny. Now that we know no one was hurt and no one was in danger, it just goes to show you, I think these animals are smarter than we give them credit for. And I think Randy has an interesting problem on his hands now, because he said, what are you going to do if you don't lock the padlock? You know, are we going to spend millions on security? No, you just lock the padlock.
And at least fodder for 3 to 4 columns for both Dave Helling and Mary Sanchez in the Kansas City Star.
I did not ride on the gorillas. I'm kind of a giraffe girl myself.
You know, there was a time, Nick, again, without trying to be too serious, but there was a time when they had a problem with some of the workforce out at the zoo. You remember the snow leopards who died many, many years ago when they were improperly locked in a box and the heat got to them. That problem, and the USDA, which inspects zoos, actually had a pretty serious problem with the way Kansas City operated its zoo. That problem seems to have been ameliorated, and this was an isolated incident from everything we understand.
A very lucky one.
Improved public safety, or is it Big Brother watching you? The ACLU is protesting a plan by Kansas City Mayor Sly James to add closed-circuit surveillance cameras to high-crime areas. Mayor James has asked for the cameras in his new budget as part of a $200,000 pilot project. But the American Civil Liberties Union says the cameras would be an invasion of privacy and would not prevent crime. How would the mayor, though, be using these?
Well, these cameras would be put in high crime areas to try to catch crime in progress, and that's how it's used in many other cities. He keeps giving the example of, if you go to London, you're on camera probably every second of every day that you are strolling around being a tourist there. Obviously, some differences between the way they do it there and the way we do it here, but if you recall, a huge campaign promise for him was he wanted that ShotSpotter technology. That is way too expensive. There's no federal money to put it in, and it's a lot more expensive than this. This could maybe be seen as kind of another way to try to get there using a little bit different technology.
Now, another talk show host on your radio station, Dana Wright, said, why would we ever want to be like Great Britain? I think that's going a little bit
too far. Yes, I think you're just fine, Nick.
Thank you very much. But, I mean, these concerns about invasion of privacy, though.
We all know you do not have an expectation of privacy on a public street. It's the reason we can bring our cameras onto the public street and shoot you when you're out standing on the public street. You don't. You do not have an expectation of privacy when you're outside walking around on city property. So for the ACLU to even come in and say this is an invasion of privacy is just patently not true. They're not putting the cameras in homes in the inner city. They are putting the cameras on street corners in the inner city. I don't see a legal problem with it at all.
Well, but the cost. I mean, it is very expensive, and you mentioned the ShotSpotter. At one point, I haven't asked them recently, but under the old chief, the police had kind of discounted that as an idea.
Right. Because there's just
they
no
had
money
looked
for it.
Well, there's no money for it, and then they figured out that it really probably wouldn't negate any crime, because criminals just tend to shift and move when they know you're hot on them. So what do? Just chase them all over the town and start putting these cameras, moving them here and there? I mean,
when the mayor, though, has been, you know, there's been concerns about what is he doing about crime in the city, and we've had so much at homicide rate and violent crime. He is trying new efforts to try and do something different.
E for effort, but let's make sure that the costs are actually going to prove to be effective.
But for $200,000 in the kind of budget that Kansas City, Missouri has, it doesn't seem like a huge amount, does it, Dave? Well,
no, but you do worry about whether it, over the long term, is an answer, not just because it's a capital cost, but to make cameras like that work, Nick, you have to have people monitor them all the time, study the tapes, keep the tapes, use the tapes, move them to other locations. It does sort of grow upon itself. It works in London largely because they are everywhere and they have a very robust, as you know, infrastructure to keep an eye on what people are doing. You don't get the sense that Kansas City would have the money to dedicate to that type of effort to, in essence, have somebody watching the cameras all the time. So it may look better than it turns out to be in terms of fighting crime going forward, unless they invest a lot more money than $200,000.
I can just see vandals going around.
Yeah.
And, I mean,
picking them off.
Exactly. Shooting them down.
Well, the other thing you'd have to have is somebody caught. You know, somebody was on the camera. We have the video. We found him or her. We, you know, convicted. And unless you get that kind of success from it, it may end up being...
And then it starts rolling. Right.
Now, Kansas City isn't the only place this week debating surveillance cameras. It's a hot topic of conversation in the Missouri legislature, where they're looking to install them in all public areas of the state capitol after a series of threats on a handful of Missouri senators. Less than a month ago, local senators Victor Callahan and Jolie Justice both found rifle target stickers on their office doors. When the stickers were removed, they found even larger crosshairs had replaced them. This week, four senators received email threats making reference to Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords. Currently, there are only surveillance cameras covering entrances and exits at the state capitol. That sounds quite remarkable in this age that there isn't more security at the Capitol, doesn't it, Chris?
You can walk right into the Capitol without ever going through any kind of security checkpoint. No metal detectors, no searches, no nothing. And there are really only limited cameras because they guard they watch the entrances of the Capitol, and there are a whole lot of entrances scattered all around on all sides. And the other interesting thing that lawmakers pointed out to me as I was covering this story is that the governor came out against installing metal detectors, but the lawmakers point out he has cameras watching the entrance of his office. They do not have cameras in the corridors of the lawmakers' offices.
So a month or two ago, we were working on this story about predatory lending and the huge exorbitant interest rates, and we went to Jeff City. And I had not been to Jeff City in a very long time, and it was myself and a photographer, the chief photographer over at KCTV5. Mm-hmm. And we walked into a side door with all of our gear and looked around and realized that we had just walked into a side door with all of our gear. And I go, is that weird to you, Rob? That, yeah. Like, there's nobody here? I could not believe that we just walked on in. And then there was a little sign that said, no weapons allowed. And that sign had been pushed off kind of by the velvet ropes. And we walked, just kind of roamed around until we found the congresswoman that we were looking for. And I could not believe, post 9/11, that there was nobody there to see what we were doing. Is that not crazy?
You know, Kansas, for a time, the Kansas Capitol in Topeka actually increased and had metal detectors and X-ray machines for, but they took those away after a time because it did sort of cause a backup of people trying to get into the state capitol. It is weird in the world we live in, Dana, you're right, but there is a message sent to the world when you have state capitals and national capitals that resemble
closed
armed camps. And I do think some lawmakers say, look, we want to make sure that people get an understanding that this is the people's house, a place for people to come and not be deterred by that type of inspection.
But you have that when you go to City Hall.
You can't go to City Hall or the courthouse.
Yes.
Got to put your cell phone in the bucket and walk through.
And there are people who will criticize it even at City Hall and have criticized.
But you did a story this week, though, where, again, they were getting threats, including references to Gabrielle Giffords, and
this
a story
was a very serious threat,
that Senator Jolie Justice was even encouraged to hire her own bodyguard.
Right. I talked to a private security guy, and he says the fact that they were targeted by name, and some of these folks have been targeted in both attempts, the one last week, the one this week, and the one last month, that those particular lawmakers should consider having private security bodyguards following them around, vary their routines. They are getting help from the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department when they're back in district over the weekends. Like today when I was talking to Jolie Justice, she had two officers at one of her public events.
But it's always a balance. I mean, they are public officials. And even, I mean, when you think about the horrid story with Gabrielle Giffords, I mean, she was at a supermarket and, outside,
and let's just remember that
doing her job.
Nixon was attacked about six blocks from where we sit.
Absolutely.
About a year and a half ago by a guy with a knife, his security has been increased.
Nixon
was
not the one attacked, that was the target.
He was the target,
he was attacked.
But you're right, but there was an effort to get at a public figure with a weapon. And I don't want to suggest that there isn't a major security problem for public figures, increased security problem, but there is, as Mary suggests, a balance. And you do want to make sure that people have a sense that the places where their laws are made are open to folks to come in. Mm-hmm.
A new Johnson County public opinion poll is out, and it gives a comprehensive snapshot of what voters there are thinking. The survey commissioned by the Overland Park Chamber Foundation found 80% of respondents favoring a tax hike to support schools. But ask, would they support increasing their taxes to support libraries, which have recently been threatened with closure, or for supporting the arts or public transportation? Support barely reached the halfway point. What do we glean of, if anything, from this latest barometer reading of Johnson County attitudes, Dave Helling?
Well, it's not headline news that Johnson Countyans support education overwhelmingly. I've argued for years that isn't necessarily because they're great supporters of great education, although in many cases they are, but because Johnson Countyans understand their property values are linked to the quality of their schools. They have a great example of what happens when school quality declines to property values, and that, of course, being Kansas City, Missouri. So I think there's always been overwhelming support for whatever it takes to maintain quality education in that county, and I think the poll illustrates that perfectly.
The library and the arts surprised me a little bit. Public transit did not. And you did a story many years ago. I actually called you about it.
Right.
And you factored the cost per rider to ride the Joe.
Yeah, it's
pretty like $1 billion because no one rides it.
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
But there is this continued
come
push,
on.
Though.
No,
there,
everyone
there,
here
there
drives.
Are, there are meetings that do take place among civic leaders to look at seeing still, they don't like to call it a bi-state tax, but a regional tax to support arts and potentially a regional transportation option in Kansas City. What does this information, this survey tell us about the opportunities for that?
I think it shows you that there is not overwhelming support for something like that. Johnson County has always been suspicious of handing over money to the Missouri side, and this does not help that effort at all.
Mary.
And they always will be, I think. I mean, they'll continuously go back to problems that Kansas City has had in terms of its own leadership, fiscal issues, all sorts of things. But I do think it also does say that Johnson County does realize that it is linked to Kansas City, Missouri proper, and they know we already have the Kauffman Center, we have the Nelson.
Exactly.
They don't
right.
have to fund these things in the, you know, by checking another tax thing.
And you look
they
at
are
the,
here.
You
they
look
know
at the,
they have those amenities.
You look at the supporters of those huge arts organizations, and a lot of them are from Johnson
Absolutely.
County. So they're already bought
their
into
money has bought into those facilities.
Yes. You know, I get a lot of phone calls in my office every week from viewers. Sometimes we can get angry people on the phone. Sometimes people even curse at me. But it was a first this week when I got someone singing on the other end of the line. Listen to this.
His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Well, my friend, we have a new hero in Kansas City. Dave Helling stepped to the plate here, hit a home run for We the People. Somebody finally had the guts, Nick, to stand up and tell the truth. That the right to initiative in Kansas City is a fraud. Not largely a fraud, but 100% fraud.
It's a celebration of Dave Helling from Clay Chastain for his column this week on Kansas City's petition process. A process, Helling argues, allows the city council to basically ignore any voter-approved ballot measure by majority vote. And in so doing, he says, fueling citizen skepticism, the conclusion, fix it or discard it. Okay, Dave, what has been the reaction to the column this week?
Well, Clay sang a song to me on my voicemail as well, so obviously he had everyone on speed dial, for which I sincerely apologize to the people of Kansas City. But having said that, I hope people understand that the column was not about Clay Chastain at all, really. It was about the process of gathering petition signatures in Kansas City, which I've talked about on this program, Nick, as you know, many, many times.
Many times.
Which is that if you're going to, I don't think you have to have a petition process, but boy, if you do, it ought to be open, transparent, fair, and it ought to take more signatures than it does now to get something on the ballot so that when Kansas Cityans consider these issues, it has some level of support. And we have none of that now. We have this weird sort of mishmash, and it's just not good for the city.
So is there any effort whatsoever by any member of the city council to in any way modify the current city charter to say we need to change
the initiative petition process?
I do want to say that Clay Chastain is the original drama queen. The guy knows how to get attention no matter what he does. And you have to give him props for that, actually. He's managed to keep his issues alive in the media.
And he's been gone for years.
Let me just say very quickly, there was an effort when the charter changed last time to reconsider the way we do petitions, and it didn't get very far. People are very protective of the petition process in Kansas City. They didn't want the number of signatures raised because they were afraid it would make it harder to go around the council. So I did get some calls from people last week who sort of said, we'll take another look, but it doesn't look like any changes. Yeah,
but you really raised some good points. I mean, people, you know, Clay becomes the joke, and he's the gift for columnists over and over again. But, I mean, we really don't have a process that works well, and yet we're kind of stuck with it, and people get so frustrated with efforts like Clay's.
Right.
But they recognize that there is a need to have this process.
Last week you had people who gathered petitions to try and stop the production of nuclear weapons
parts
at City Hall. Their petitions were also rejected. Regardless of the merits of that, Nick, the fact is they gathered petitions in good faith. The council put themselves between those petitions and the people. That's not the way the system is supposed to work.
And you don't get this opportunity in Kansas. You don't get to do this in Overland Park or Mission or Prairie Village, Dana. This is a uniquely Kansas City opportunity here.
And Missouri.
Yes.
And it's fine if you don't have it. I'm not arguing that you have to have a petition process. But if you do, make it open, make it fair, make it transparent, and make it important. That's what I was trying to say.
And that is our week in review. Our thanks to our news reviewers from the Kansas City Star, Mary Sanchez, and from 41 Action News, Chris Hernandez. From News Radio 98.1 FM KMBZ, Dana Wright, who you can hear weekday afternoons from 2 to 6 on Radioactive with Scott Parks. And from the Star, Dave Helling, who co-stars with hundreds of other people at the newspaper every day. I'm Nick Haynes. From all of us here at KCPT, thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.